You wouldn't need to come to them. It's going to describe the presentation.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you. We praise you. We give honor and glory to your name for this time that you've given us. We commit this family forum into your hands. We pray that you come down and bless every heart, bless every soul. We're looking up to you for a great time of fellowship, and we believe that you will help us, oh God, even as we learn from your word. We pray that you help us to open our hearts and apply every word that comes from you to it, oh Lord, that we'll be able to practice. And we pray that all this bring sweet fellowship and good time in our homes, oh God, all for the glory of your name. We thank you, Lord, for we know you will do more than beyond we think or ask. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay. This is going to be the last family forum for the year 2016. And we shall be looking at this important topic, resolving this concrete family conflict carefully. We want to pray that God himself will guide us in this topic. I mentioned to the Manchester congregation this morning that we don't have a family expert here. Not an expert. We have Jesus Christ as the expert. And we all want to look into this together. We also encourage people that don't have any conflict at all in their family, either between husband, wife, or children, parents, or whatever, to still be present, because we need to learn from you. We need some input from you. So we are all doing this together. And by the end we finish, by the special grace of God, we are hoping that the Lord God Almighty will have given us something that we will need to pray about. That I will need to pray about, and you too will need to pray about, so that the Lord can give us peaceful homes and then peaceful churches, so that we can concentrate on the work of the kingdom that the Lord has given us, rather than concentrating on our conflict, resolving conflict here and there in different ways. So, we are going to have two sessions today. The first session is going to be this discussion or a seminar, if you like. What I've tried to do is that I've taken some materials that I want to share with you this afternoon. I've taken some materials from some people that know better than myself, that ask for themselves, and they know about family issues. And some of you might have been hearing about Dawson. Some of you might have been hearing about Warren. I've taken some materials from them. I've also taken some material from our own church publications on resolving conflicts which we have in different areas. And guess what? I've also taken material from my own personal professional study. I used to be a lecturer, and one of the topics that I have treated many times within the behavioral system design and installation is conflict resolution in organizations. So I have some things that when I used to teach that topic, I used to connect it even with the Bible in terms of what theory say. That I say, this is not theory, this goes with the Bible. So I've combined all of these things together to put this material together to share with you, and of course to hear from you as well. If I just ask some of you about conflict, or let's first of all talk about husband and wife. I got married when I was 30 years old. I got married to my wife who was 28 at the time. Now you know the difference in terms of age between my wife and myself. Before that time, that 30 years, I didn't spend it with Stella. 28 years of Stella, she didn't spend with me. If you want to know how she has spent that 28 years, find Calvary in Chapel. If you want to know how I spent my 30 years before we met, I can tell you some of them. But I think the point I'm trying to make is that before we got married, we were on different training, different socialization concepts, different educational systems, different upbringing, different value systems, everything different. And now we got married at 30 and 28. And then what do you think will happen? Everything to them, is it? Because two shall be one. Those differences will be there. Those issues will be there. One of the things that some of you have heard many times, and I said to Manchester this morning that they have been to have heard something that they have heard before, as I mentioned, and that has to do with my own self and Stella to some extent. And since we are talking about homes, I was raised in a very, very poor family. Stella was raised in a very, very affluent family. And so, there are certain things that she was brought up to do and not to do, and to touch and not to touch, or give in certain way. You're talking now of a child of rich people and a child of poor people. And now when they come together, there will be difference, isn't it?
Yes.
Obviously. My wife would tell me many times when I say, let's walk. Look, my parents didn't think we could do that. I was wearing this type of shoes to go to school. You went on, we have food to go to school. And that's what happened. So you can see the differences that are coming on. I think the point I'm making here is that during the time before we got married, we have acquired a certain set of values, preferences, standards, and life and dislike habits. And the fact that we are married will not automatically cement that and then we become one in everything. Perhaps we have some couples here that are like that. Immediately you got married, all your preferences, your values, your habits, your likes, your dislikes, everything just pop. And that was very so, it is from reasonable to expect that simply because you are married to each other, you will be thinking exactly the same thing on every subject. And perhaps some people, they are not expecting any disagreement in their marriage. But I think the point I want us all of us to think this afternoon is that conflict is a fact of life. And it's just because we don't understand that conflict, and I want to pray that the Lord will help us to know what it means in terms of conflict. Because really, when we use the word conflict, we think that they are fighting, they are boxing each other. We are not talking of destructive conflict, there are some constructive ones as we shall see. Okay, now listen to this point. I get this from my experience as a pastor. Some people will say that my wife and my husband, they are not compatible. We are just not compatible. Do you know what they are saying? They are just simply stating the fact. Because no two people are compatible. We are not compatible. We are not compatibility. We are talking of you now being the same thing. There's nothing like that being compatible. We are using this word loosely here. I want you to understand what I'm saying in the context of what I'm saying. Because some people, when they say that, what I like, she dislikes. What I want, she doesn't want. That is natural. And that is why we did counsel before any marriage that you are going to marry someone that, irrespective of how many years you have been to have your courtship, isn't it? One who have a long courtship, isn't it? So I can understand each other, isn't it? The problem or the issue with that is that whatever I'm going through courtship, which I went through with my wife before we got married, you feel like courtship. Courtship is different from marriage. In courtship, anything can be agreed to. Anything you want to do, I want to be, where you want to be, no issue. It is different thing after I do. And then that is then when we see that there is something here. I think I came across this that people that are always using incompatibility as excuse, they need to grow. They just need to grow. They just need to accept that not being compatible, you then need to practice what is called flexibility. If you are flexible, you will see that that incompatibility, you can get something good out of it. You don't see different, you don't see the same thing, you don't see things in the same way, you see things differently, it can be something good. Without doubt, as Christians, we all know that man and woman were each divinely fashioned in a unique manner. We have our gender uniqueness, and God has made us to complement each other in those uniqueness that we have. Part of my introduction to it is that conflict is not the issue. Conflict itself is not the problem. The problem is our reaction to the conflict. Disagreement is not the problem. Differences, these are not the problem. The major problem is what, how we react. And as Christians, the writer that we follow those guidelines in how we handle this situation so that we don't hear the effectiveness of our Christian testimony. Now, if there is a conflict in the family, I come to the question. If there is a conflict in the family, what do you think are the consequences of unresolved conflict in the family? Or resolve conflict in the family. What do you think are the consequences? Okay. When the host branch, we got to be open up. They don't need to hide anything. This is a forum where, honestly speaking, there is nothing wrong. I will give you some examples that I have had with my wife. Because it's not a bad thing, and how we are resolving that. So please. If you have anything to share, let us share, because the enemy of our soul is just using this to cause issues that shouldn't be issued in many homes. Yes, unresolved conflict, what are the consequences? Yes, your man there, God bless you. You want to leave? Okay, one of our children. What?
I'm not married yet, but when we live together, like once in a while, when we step on each other's toes, it results in unknowingly, you'll be saying to yourself that, I know what I'm doing, I just want to stay away from him, but you're keeping malice. So by the time you don't want to resolve the conflict, it starts causing malice between the family, and you stop talking to each other for a while, and you know, from this, that's not good for the family.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, Sister Robert.
Unresolved conflict to me, it actually leads to bitterness of the heart.
Sure.
Yeah, bitterness. There's no happiness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you. I hope you people from all our branches are hearing. If you want to contribute anything, phone those two people, they will tell us what you want to contribute if you have anything to contribute. Yes, more?
Yeah, the consequences of unresolved conflict will definitely break the family altar. There will be no time for, they won't pray together again. Start from there.
Thank you. In a big family altar, yes, it's Josie.
It can rather lead to bring down the marriage separation at first or divorce.
See what that can lead to, or resolve conflict, separation, and divorce. Yes, the power of God is in our hands. No peace at home. Have you said yours, Sister Margaret?
Yeah, apart from diversity and divides the whole family. Some kids, some children, my dad, I'm for dad, some my dad, I'm for mom. And then it's fed their conflict because of that one conflict which was not resolved.
Here, vision at home. Any more? Happiness at home, isn't it? Stress at home, isn't it? Anxiety at home, isn't it? Coolness between family members. If we read 1 Peter 3, 7, 1 Peter 3, 7, has something to say. 1 John 4, 20 and 21. 1 Peter 3, 7, 1 John 4, 20 and 21.
Likewise, Jesus said, walk with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife, as unto the beautiful vessel, and bring her together of the grace of life, that your parents do not be hindered.
Do you hear that? Prayer not being hindered. Yes? 1 John 4, 20 and 21, please. Anybody?
1 John 4, 20. If a man say, I love God and hated his brother, he is a liar, for he that loveth not his brother, whom he hath not seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? 21. And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God loves his brother also.
Okay. Are we getting the point there? If you have unresolved conflict, there will be hatred, and as a result of that, there will be this fellowship with God. We don't want to be in a situation that there is this fellowship between us and God. You must have fellowship with God. And if you don't want that fellowship you have with God to be broken, be sure you have also fellowship with your wife, your husband, your children, and of course, the other people. We are just focusing on the whole in terms of some consequences. Before we move on, a straightforward question here. Is it good for someone from poor family? And this is for me. Is it good for someone from a poor family to marry someone from affluent family? I've just given myself as an example. Whosoever is asking, and I have no regret. And I don't think Stella has ever told me one time that, why did I do this? Or why did I marry somebody that didn't go to nursery and then go for dinner, shoe and salt at the younger age and being carried to school and things like that? That has never been an issue at all. So my answer is, this is not a determinant anyway for getting married. The most determinant factor for getting married is to pray and know who God wants to marry. If it's from poor family, hallelujah. If it's from rich family, praise God. In as much as you pray and it is for the God. Okay, let's move to what is conflict. And this is very important. It's important simply because we need to know what we are talking about. That we are not, as I said before, we are not talking of people boxing each other. When there is any contention, any disagreement between two people who have different opinions, for example, or different perspectives, it's just different. Well, it is written here that the word conflict itself is not found in the Bible. And we have some other words that connote conflict in the Bible. If you look at these references, they are all referring to conflict. When the Bible uses the word a dispute, it has to do with differences. And that is from Acts 17:17. When the Bible uses the word division among you, the cause of division has to do with differences. Quarrel, strife, contention. These are all available to describe interpersonal differences in the Bible. So we have things like this in the Bible, conflict. And we found out that God knows that this may happen, and no wonder He has created opportunity for us to find a way to resolve this whenever it happens, as we shall see from the Word of God. I think I've already mentioned about the general, I think I've already mentioned something about this in terms of our desires, expectations, fears, and things from one person to another. And we can see that when it was mentioned in the book of James chapter 4 from verses 1 to 3 about the sources of all these kind of things. This kind of thing in terms of desires, expectations, pollution of desires can happen between husband and wife, and as well as between children and parents. Now, how about among sanctified individuals? Is unity uniformity? Unity is not uniformity. I think it's important for us to get that. And that is why, even among sanctified individuals, unity is not automatic. As we shall see, in terms of what we do. The Word of God says that we should endeavor. Endeavor, that's a big word, that's a good word. That is, do all within your power, as a wife, as children, as husband, to keep the unity. And the Lord will help us to do that.
Amen.
This says that God is the one who made us to be different. It's God Himself who has done that. He gave us our individual characteristics and preferences. And when we are saved, or when we get married, those differences are still there. Those characteristics are still there. Those preferences are still there. When individuals now move from dealing with those differences, what happens is that it escalates into conflict, and of course into some of the things that we mentioned, if we fail to resolve this quickly. And the aim of this forum is to look into the Word of God and share together whenever this happens, what and what we can do. And God is going to help us.
Amen.
When the spouse fails to understand the physiological and emotional differences of the other, conflict occurs. When I was preparing this material, I actually came across a study about the differences in terms of physiological and emotional differences between men and women. And if God can help us to get that, I think Stella will bear me out, but I think I mentioned this perhaps a few days ago, that as I was preparing for this forum, there are some things I'm learning. In terms of women are just different. If I read some of these things to you, you will just, maybe some of you will know it better than me already. But in terms of our brain, the way the Lord has made it, in terms of our metabolism, the way the Lord has made it, in terms of our thinking faculty, we are not talking of salvation here. Salvation is salvation.
Yes.
Yes. Individual individual differences are individual differences.
Amen.
If you are a wife or you are a husband and you don't know that yet, I will actually recommend some books for you to read, which I'm just reading myself. Not that I know it, but if I have a copy, because I couldn't write a lot of this down, I copied this. Do you want me to read some of them for you to hear?
Yes.
You want to hear?
Yes, please.
Yes. Yes.
Woman's blood contains more water.
That's true.
20% fewer red cells. Listen to this. And since red cells supply oxygen to the body, she tires more easily and is more prone to faint. Our constitutional viability is therefore strictly a long-term matter. When the working day in a factory under wartime conditions was increased from 10 to 12 hours, accidents among women increased 150%. The rate of accidents among men did not increase significantly. Men are 50% stronger than women in good strength. Women's heart beat more rapidly, 80 versus 72 beats per minute on average. I didn't know all that. So if I'm talking to my wife, and as you know that well, if your heart beat here is different, in terms of responses. Men and women differ in every cell of their bodies. This is because it carries a different chromosome pattern that is the basic source of their maleness and femaleness. Women have greater constitutional vitality, perhaps because of the chromosome difference. Men have higher rate of basal metabolism than women. They are different in their skeletal structure. And these are the things that I believe God Himself has made. Sorry, this is from France. I can speak only Yoruba. Toyi, attend to Brother Bobo for me, please. Maybe they have no problem. Okay, so don't let me waste your time on that. Perhaps some wives, before I read this, my wife always mentioned many things to me about this. That in terms of women are different from men. And I doubt whether you have read this book on Dawson. Adoption. Perhaps maybe she was basing this on the way I will react, or the way I will do things, and she will just see that it's not as hard as that, perhaps. Or you shouldn't have reacted that way, perhaps. Just because I'm a man and you're a woman. And may God help us to understand all these differences when they come to play on any of the things that we see. So in terms of our physiological and emotional makeup, we know that we are different and we react to situations differently. Maybe by the grace of God now, conflict will now reduce in many homes where you will know when your man or your husband does something, you just know he's a man. And when your wife should do something, say, woman. And we are different. Okay, so I've talked about the general causes. Okay, let's identify some specific causes. Okay, another question here. Will the church bless a marriage where the man does not have a job? Is that not a question that is already answered? Or maybe because I'm a pastor and I know the answer, that's why I'm talking. Can somebody answer this question? Where the man, the head of the home, the one whom God says, must provide for the need of the home, does not have a job, and wants to marry? It's a genuine question. Any answer from the floor?
Yeah, well, maybe before I could, maybe if anyone wants to say something, you can go.
Okay.
Yeah, I think you said that doesn't matter whether one is rich or poor. So even if one is doesn't have a good job, which means they're poor, it doesn't matter in a family. So I don't think it matters at all.
So I think it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter for a man to have a job.
If he doesn't have a job.
If the wife.
If the man doesn't have a job.
If the man doesn't have a job.
Doesn't matter.
He's poor.
Okay.
And he's poor.
Don't forget poor. Don't worry about poor. The question that demands is poor. The question is, will the church bless a marriage where the man does not have a job?
Before marriage or while in the course of marriage the man loses a job?
No, I want to believe it's marriage. Can you celebrate the
man does not have a job? Okay.
I want to believe, please, the questionnaire, you are hearing us, if that is not what you mean, write back so that we can clarify everything. What you mean is, if the person has no job, can we solemnize them?
Sorry. Can I ask one question on that?
The questionnaire is not here.
Yeah, but I wanted to see maybe from another perspective where the questionnaire is
maybe coming from.
Probably the person has actually been preparing for marriage in the past, but he lost the job, and he knows that one of the requirements of church is that you've got to make sure.
Is it church?
One of the requirements of the home, rather. Yeah, that you have to get something doing with your hand.
Mm-hmm.
So I think maybe the person might be asking. Maybe it might be you don't need to have. Job, you might be a businessman or you might, I don't know, that kind of perspective.
Sure, God bless you. So you see, that's why at times certain things we cannot deal with it adequately because we don't know what it means. So we are now having different perspectives to it. But maybe we should just change one that we believe. We have many young people here in Manchester, I can see them. And I know in our other churches where you are listening, they've just sent me a text now from Spain. We are enjoying the program. I know they are watching. They are there. Right. Okay. We have some young people here. So let's take it from the angle of somebody who wants to get married. He has prayed. God has said, Sister Mary or Sister Joan is your wife, and there is no job. With the church solemnize that. That's what we are doing. You want to say something?
I don't think it's important whether two or three. I don't think it's important who earns the most money as long as you have that love. I think it's more important to have fun in marriage than worry about the money. So, I turn it off, but while I was at home, I did the washing, the cooking, the ironing, and all the other things. And then when I got my job, we both took the responsibilities.
Okay, right. For those of you who may not be getting that, is love should be the prerequisite. When there is love, forget job for now.
Well, from my perspective, I wanted to say the church only advises people to do what is right. And we wouldn't mandate one to be having a job, but it is good. We will advise the good thing that we expect, that is expected of you in your home. If you say my wife is going to be supplying for the home, well, if you have agreed on that, God bless you. We wouldn't say we're stopping that. We only advise.
Okay. Well, it is true that our main focus is when people want to get married, we believe that is from the word of God, about if a man, you remember, cannot provide, is what? That is from the word of God. And that is why we always advise that it's good for a man to have means of sustaining the family before you bring a wife, and then family will start. As Brother Mark said, I want to believe that is a good advice in line with the word of God. We will really advocate that. If this individual is in that category, we pray that the Lord is going to give you a job.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. And you will understand eventually the importance of being able to occupy the place that God wants you to occupy, which is to be the head of the home. And we have done this in the past, and as I'm talking now, I can just think of 1, 2, 3 in my head, and they may be listening to this forum, whereby they were to get married, and the wife has accommodation of her own, the wife has the good job of her own, then the brother living with the parents, the brother has no job. And the brother, of course, was of the opinion that I just moved to my wife. Nothing wrong in that. After all, it's the house of your wife to be. However, the brother was advised about the importance of being able to contribute to the maintenance of your home. Pray and let God give you a job. And the brother understood clearly, very well. And he waited, he found a job, eventually they are married. They have now moved out of the sister's house to their own house that they bought together.
Amen.
That is what we will advise. Let me read other things that they have said here before we continue. And this is very important, I guess. It says this. This is actually an advice for the church. And I would have just left it the way it has come for the church. But because there are some other things mentioned about it, I think it's good for me to make it open. The church should look into its strategies of resolving conflicts between husbands and wives. If the success rate is poor, the ministry should look inward and find out why. Did you get that? Then the same person wrote, the church is not very successful in conflict resolution because busybody women talk unnecessarily and Satan uses such women to make some conflicts unsolved. So the reason I'm reading this is if we have busybody women and men, they better know that they are causing problems. Because here, the church will do its part. And then I want this questionnaire from wherever this has come. I don't know where, they just sent it to me from our contacts here that is Kenny. From wherever you are, please notice that even in the word of God, if you look into the conflict resolution strategy that Jesus put in place, we will see that after you've gone through all the process of resolving conflict, at the end of it, Jesus says that if that conflict refused to be resolved, do you remember? So it can still happen, and I'm not in any way defending the church, praying that God will give the church more wisdom to use in resolving conflicts at home, and perhaps that is why we're having this forum, so that we won't even need to have to be intervening in your home in resolving conflicts. The church can move on when there is peace in your home. Peace in every home, then the church can concentrate on the spreading of the gospel. And we pray that the Lord is able to do that.
Amen.
But most times, it's just because one person is stubborn and there's nothing you can do. Even the word of God says, in terms of when we try to do that, and we say, no way. The word of God says that, well, even when the church has tried its best to do one thing or the other, then you have to just be that person and just to pray for that person. So, that's what I want to say about that. Okay, specific causes of conflict. Let's focus now on both. When we talk of husband and wife, and children and parents, what are some specific causes that you can identify? Specific causes. Some of them. Yes, quick, please. Those who are carrying the mic, maybe if some young people can jump up. Lack of communication. May God help us to learn to communicate.
Amen.
Part of my teaching also has to do with communication in organization. And I used to tell people that there is something in communication, there is the message, and there is to come from the sender to the receiver. The sender must encode the message and transmit that message. The receiver must decode the message and receive the message. Before this message goes through all of this, it has a lot of problems or what we call in organizational terms noises that can affect what is happening. So many times, we are not aware of those noises. The noises are not that people are shouting. The noises may be in the way, you know, when you say, have I not said before that I love you? There is already a noise. Not my voice. Then you can see my physique. If you love somebody and you are saying it, if you get the code, you will shoot the person. That is not true love. Are you with me? So you communicate love with loving gesture, isn't it? There is a noise when that loving gesture is not there. And you are trying to say, I love you. You say you love you with a smile, isn't it? As opposed to with a frowning face and characteristic that may be questionable. Anyway, so we need to be aware of the noises that can come in between the sender and receiver. And I don't know, even in my own home, I'm still learning how to communicate well with my wife, and I want to believe she's learning too. And all of us have to learn that. May God come and teach us. That can lead to conflict. Because that miscommunication can lead to misunderstanding, misperception, and misinterpretation, miss, and then conflict, and before you know it, many other things. Yes, thank you. Bad communication. Yes, more specific causes. Yes, let's listen to, okay, some people that, let's listen to people that are perceiving.
Keep silent, maybe I'm misunderstanding. Keep silent, you don't want to talk
to each other. Okay. Some of us are in that category. And we're going to learn to talk about this today. You know when somebody wants to open something up and the other person just decided, I am not going to talk about this. They are not giving room for resolution. They are not giving room for reconciliation. And we will see that at certain times, if my wife will not mind here, many times I just tell my wife, I don't know what to say. With all these things that I'm saying, you don't know what to say. Nothing has come to my mind. And maybe she just needs to know that I am not a woman. I am a man. Many words that women will speak, a man will just say in two words or three words, then you want it. That all? May God teach us how to communicate. Yes.
Money matters.
May God deliver us.
Amen.
We just study in our lesson this morning. This is where we should apply two shall be one. Why? It's a shame, you know. You know that for this past 16 years that I've been a pastor, I've seen many shameful things. If I can bring this in, 3 years back, a husband and a wife had a big fight at home. On what? On, you know, it's not now that you can get television on your phone. You can get television everywhere, even on your computer. You don't need those days of television, it's just television. I want to watch this program, and I want to watch that program, and it's only one TV they have, and that became a fact. Isn't that terrible? Now look at this issue of money also. Why would I want to say that the money I have, do I have that money, or the money we have? When we say two shall be one, this is where this should be applied. Why should money be administered? Unfortunately, in many homes, I know, some people will tell me because he spends too much. Well, I appreciate there may be areas that we really need to iron and love and ensure it's okay. But it's a shame when we let money be the main issue. And I'm not talking of when the wife has to go and buy, you understand?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. The man said yes. Money matters. They got delivered.
Yes.
Yes. To be.
Okay. For you to understand what you have done wrong and when to actually apologize.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Specific causes. You don't know the time that I'm wrong and I should apologize.
Yes.
Let's be open, let's be open. Sister Mercy, yes, I'll not be telling you about
it. Self-centeredness.
Thank you.
Others, they are only thinking about themselves. Uh-huh. They don't think even the feeling of the other person that they are doing that to. If you consider others, it will resolve many of the conflicts.
Thank you very much. I have to tell you, selfishness, only thinking of your own, of your own. How about the other person? Yes, ma'am?
Background with different backgrounds where we are coming from.
Okay.
Yes. Some children are taught from their young age how to share information among the parents. Others don't.
Background. God deliver us. May God help us. And yes, we are from different backgrounds. I come from a background that is called the Yorubas. They have different ways of saying or doing things. And if you have a wife or a husband from another background that is not your culture, especially the Yorubas, I'm talking of my Yoruba function. And that's another group from
the Bele.
Or the Igbo, or the Lausas, or whatever. And you have taught different things, and the way to react and do things. Something that a wife, who is a Yoruba, will not want to mention, and the husband, who is somebody, if not a Yoruba, will say, what are you keeping? I can't say it. I just can't, how would I go and say that? What is wrong in saying that? Again, even though this thing can lead to some conflict, I think part of what we need to learn, that we want to pray that God will help us to understand, is that from a different background. And God can help us to harmonize that. Yes, please.
Again, about communication. For example, those who have the family on the surgery, they don't spend time with their families or their kids, and they don't talk to them. That causes communication to be difficult,
and
they
don't
really talk to
their parents. Thank you. Wonderful. Thank you so much for that point. You know, I have a material that I'm preparing on how children, talk of parenting as parents, the parents teaching children, the children becoming teaching parents. And that is what we are hearing, that of course we don't expect that. That children should be the one teaching the parents. We want the parents, that's the word of God, am I right?
Yes.
The parents should teach the children, and if you don't do that, There is no time given to that for your children, no opportunity. You say, why are you not asking this? Why would they ask? That cordiality is just not there for them to ask. Yes, more on specific causes of conflict. Yes, it's diabetes.
Differences in needs or priorities.
Differences in
needs or priorities.
Okay, needs or priorities. Differences. Yes, Araba, we shout it out.
Why is it that it is meant only that there are both and
then it is passed down? Let's listen.
That's number one. Number two is that right that when men have assignments in the church and the woman or the lady or female, they are not interested, they want to say it's evil preach or something like that, you go to the church, we come to join you later.
Thank you. Let's take the first one. The first one, we only use that as a point in terms of, as mentioned, men. Both men and women is what I was referring to. I did mention that none of the two should claim ownership. That's what you mean. It is our money. The husband's money is husband and wife's money. The wife's money is husband and wife's money. It is our money. So we are not saying, wife, you can do whatever you like with your salary of so much per month. There's the husband one that's going to the back. That's not what you are saying. That's number one. Then number two is on. Okay. Well, there is a conflict in that one, brother, and the reason for that conflict is varied. Even if a wife will say to the husband that they are just doing hypocrisy, just doing the choice to work and this and that, if I hear something like that, I will say, brother, honestly speaking, it is important for you to stop working first. Stop working first. Because if your wife sees you like that, there's a problem. You need to first of all go and resolve. Honey, it's an opportunity God has given me and I'm doing my little part. Why are you saying that? Maybe perhaps the work you should do at home, you are not. And then the poor lady is dying under heavy job at home. And here in the church, you can run up and down. Running up and down, the one at home is God's work. Looking after the baby or children is God's work. Cleaning the house is God's work. Then you want to go and clean the church and the home is not to be on my head alone. I will say you are hypocrite. What are you going to do in that church? Let's sit down and talk. So I want to tell that brother to please go and settle that thing first before you even continue to work. Yes, any other specific? Okay, another point that has come in. A point to God's parents is that they should forgive their conflict, especially in the home with kids. The kids will always be affected and be watching, hearing the parents. Thank you for that contribution, wherever that has come from. Yes?
Bringing in third parties.
Thank you.
Respecting third parties' suggestion more than the wife or the husband's suggestion. Some people say, my mom said, or my dad said I should be like this. Once you mention your dad or your mom, then you refuse to be married.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay, that's the influence of the in-laws or even friends. Influence of the in-laws can cause conflict at home. We are looking at the causes of conflict. You have one?
The thing with families where you have to remember is when you've got mother and father, some of the fathers lead families to other people. When a family splits up, you don't realise the drama they cause, and it's the children who suffer more than the adults. The other thing that needs to be mentioned is when you've got two people, a man and a woman, where children are concerned, both parents need to be at home and you need to be in a situation where to manage and spend too many hours at work, because in my job I've seen too many families where they split up because the man spends too many hours in the office, so that needs to be cut down. So that when you have that quality time together, that's when they enjoy it best.
Yes.
Thank you. Oh. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, just one other question from my friend.
Okay.
He said, why is that it's a sex that is causing problems in most homes?
No, I've not had that. I don't know where it is. Nobody has said anything like that. Okay, it's a question that we discussed from children. And I want to believe, that is a valid question, honestly, but there are some questions I want to just put aside for now. I appreciate that we didn't agree, allow for peace not to be in our midst. I want to be very careful about something that we discussed. That is something separate that if that person can please bring it up with me or with your pastor, proper guidance will be given by God's grace. Okay, even when some people believe that two shall become one, I think I mentioned this. This is what it means. That's not what it means. It's not that kind of alignment. Perhaps some of you have mentioned too on the physical exhaustion in terms of the type of work we do. The result of which there is no quality time for one another. Do we know the meaning of quality time? I believe you do. We are all living in modern society, huh? It's not from that little village that I came from. It's in modern society. Quality time. If you don't have quality time with your spouse, it will lead to conflict. Money matters, we've talked about that. Well, we talked about the comfort of the in-laws. Bringing up if something has been settled and forgiving in the past, and you are still referring to it, that is not good enough. This is often the cause of conflict between my wife and myself. Temperature. I am a cold-blooded person. My wife is not cold-blooded. And we must sleep under the same roof. I want to leave the window open. The window open? I'm cold! And if you don't, if you close the window, I'm hot! Who actually said this about his wife too. He said, so I'm not the only one. And then he said, I feel that this kind of conflict will continue till Jesus comes. Unless God will change the temperature. Many times we may have to find a way, close, open, open, close, one side of the group open, another side of the group close, and that kind of a thing. You know, there are some conflicts you have to live with.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes.
What has been your okay, then we talk about selfishness. Look at selfishness. It was Dawson who said that the next slide, I think it will be there. Dawson in his book, Love for Life, said that there are two kinds of people in the world, the givers and the takers. Givers and the takers. If other than wife, they are givers, you have a wonderful, loving relationship, and that will cause conflict. But when one is a giver and the other is a taker, there's an issue here. And yet, God does give the giver to the taker.
How do you do that?
God himself.
God bless you. Okay. There are also differences with disciplining children. The husband believes the children should be disciplined this way, the husband believes it should be another way. The two of them don't have any issue. The issue is the way they are dealing with their children. May God give them the grace to align on that area. Because we are going to have a divided pool, the children now running to mommy when they know what mommy will support, running to daddy when they know what daddy will support, and little, we will not know that we already have issues, big one at home. So these are some of the differences. These are some of the causes of conflict. We know there are so many, many, many more that we cannot mention. But we know that God is in heaven, and will help us to resolve all our conflict.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Passion. We're going to stand up wherever you are. We're going to have one song. We want to stand up, and then at the end of that song, we will look at the resolution strategies.
Answer.
But we are serving a God that has the answer.
Yes.
And And when we pray together, I have worked with people in the past, men of God, who have really worked with conflict. And they have told us, indeed, that they don't have an answer. And many times, God Himself has intervened to provide answers. I appreciate that, yes, there may be some things that some ladies do not want to say to men leaders. Honestly, I don't know. I'm just gathering this from this person. I don't know the person. But please, if you have a genuine concern and you want to share this with women, this may be coming from your wife or your husband, I don't know. Please, you can, without mentioning the name of the people concerned, you can mention this to me, and I can tell you that by the grace of God, there are support in the church whereby we have people that by the grace of God, they pray together with you, they share experiences with you, and those issues, if you want a God strategy for solving it, by the grace of God, we believe it can be resolved by God's grace. I may not have all the answers to all these questions that you are raising, but perhaps if we sit down to talk together, it may be of help to us. On the question of sessions like this, that is true. In all our churches, there are sessions like this, and we know that there is no way sessions like this will solve all problems. But that still doesn't mean that we shouldn't have this general kind of sessions to share together. And where we have some specific issues, please feel free to bring that up with any of the leaders in the church. May not even be a pastor, may be any of the pastors, may even be any of the ministers, and by the grace of God, if you are looking for a way out to be of help, we are in the apostolic faith, we have training in sessions. Okay, Brahmak is reminding me of other conferences that we put in place where we share together, we discuss openly, focus conferences, male conferences, female conferences, where we share and we discuss together to do some of these things. And we are not claiming that it's all 100% okay to answer all the questions. God is going to answer all our questions.
Amen.
If you are having a conflict or an issue that you just don't want to raise with anybody in the church, I will say, please, raise it up with God, and God will help you to resolve it. And for those who want to raise anything with the church, please, feel free to do so, and the church will go through the word of God to do the little we can do to see what we can do to help. Hatred and divided home, or resolve conflict, what does that mean? Okay, hatred is to come. Okay, thank you. Okay, let's go straight to how conflict should be resolved. You know, I did mention that I want to distill from my experience as an educator in organizational behavior. Whenever we treat conflict resolution, we use this organizational model. Can I have the picture of the model, please? And all I'm trying to say is that anytime I use models like this to teach, when I was teaching, really, I do think of Christians in terms of, wow, some of these agree with Christians and some may not agree with Christians. If we have fans in terms of, and I'm talking now of organizational model, and you will see where the word of God comes in and where it conflicts with the word of God. Okay? And we can make use of this in our conflict with anybody, and for more especially at home. We have five strategies. The first one, you can take any of them, but I will take them with you. The first one is on competing. The goal of that is, it is good to win. It is good to win. And what that one is simply saying is, let me try to get it. I'm talking of this one. It's good to win. That has to do with when the level of assertiveness, that is, where you have to satisfy your own concern, is very hard. It's very hard. Okay? That's your own concern. Your level of assertiveness is very high. And your level of showing concern for others.
Thank you. And the level of showing concern for others is very low. That leads to uncooperation.
And then your own issue. What you are going to have is it is good to win. You are competing. That is what is called win-lose situation. In this conflict, I must win, you must lose. Will a Christian want to do that?
No.
Come down the man, the avoiding strategy. The avoiding strategy is where it is lose-lose. I must not win this and I will not let you to win. So it's lose-lose. And that is, I don't care about myself, unassertiveness, and I don't care about you. Okay? Will a Christian want to do that?
No.
In organizations, each of these, the way we teach it is that there are certain situations you do that. There are certain situations, I'm not teaching that. I'm just teaching, I'm going to somebody. Now the next one is that one in the middle, compromising. Is where we need to split this into half. You get half, I get half. And that is, the goal is to find the middle ground. And that is where you think, my concern for this to 50%, my concern for you must also be to 50%. That's compromise. Perhaps, depending on the situation, I want to say, there are certain things Christians may want to do like that. Okay? Let's come to accommodating strategy. Accommodating strategy is where you yield. You know the kind of thing that Abraham did to Lot? He yielded. When he called Lot and he said that let there be no strife between you and I, take first. So that is like a kind of loose win situation. Okay? I don't mind you lose. I want you to win. Does that sound Christian?
Yes.
The last one is me, I must get the best. You must get the best. Collaborate. Win, win. As opposed to lose, lose. Maybe I am thinking aloud, there are situations like that at home with my wife. On some situations, I cannot think of any example now. But I think the one I want to recommend according to the word of God, that will always be a winning attitude before God all the time, is the one that for yourself, you put yourself down, you raise others. I think that agrees more with the fact. You will see what God will do for you when you do that. What he did for Abraham in that situation, he will do for you.
Amen.
When Abraham put himself, okay, no, Lord, take the first one. Have your way. Do it first. And Lord did. Remember what happened to the land of Sodom and Gomorrah? And you have to remember what happened to Abraham. Okay, I'm not the only way we follow this strategy. However, there are some things there that when I used to teach this, I used to think of, wow, this is Christian in some area, and this one is not Christian in some other areas. This one is running past now. Proverbs 19:11. Can somebody quickly read that, please? Another person to read 1 Peter 2:23. Those are key to resolving conflict. These verses are very key to resolving conflict. Proverbs 19:11, 1 Peter 2:23. Husband, wives, children, parents, please take these words seriously. Proverbs 19:11.
Deferred his anger, and it is his glory to pass over a transgression.
Okay? Are we getting that? To overlook offenses. Overlook offenses. Some people say, pick your battles. Okay, the next one.
When he was reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that righteously.
Don't you think that is like accommodation strategy? In terms of Jesus, revile, he decided not to revile back. Threatened, he committed himself to him that can judge righteously. We can do that in our comfort. And God will help us.
Amen.
Well, there are some things that you still want to open up. There are some things that you still want to talk about. It's not everything, because I do tell people that if you think you cannot pray over an issue and let the blood of Jesus take it away, take it up. That if you can pray and you mean it in the bottom of your heart, that there is no grudge there with your wife, husband, your children, or your parents, something happened, and you just want to overlook it. You just want it to go without taking it up. God bless you. But where you cannot do that, it is not a sin to take it up. And that is why Jesus Christ set up a resolution strategy that even though he did not say that between husband and wife, but husband and wife can make use of that too. The one that we found in Matthew 5. I just love it. And I know many people, they don't like following through. But if you follow that through, when something happened, Jesus Christ said, what did he say we should do first? That conflict that you cannot overlook. That thing that is causing issue between you and your wife, or you and somebody, that you just, you know, I can't overlook this. What did Jesus say? The first step. Do we know? Matthew 5 from 23. You don't know? What is it there? Thank you. Go to the present first. Talk to your wife first. Talk to your husband first. Talk to your children first. Talk to your parents first. Jesus is not trying to say here that you want to cover sin. No, but he doesn't want that being exposed anyway. Why will you be exposed outside? When you can talk to your spouse and that can be sorted. Let somebody read Romans 14:19 and James 1:19. Romans 14:19, James 1:19.
Romans chapter 14, verse 19. Let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace, and things wherewith one may edify one another.
Is that not wonderful? God's children are peacemakers. If you have peace in your heart, you will be pursuing peace at all costs. Yes, James 1:19.
Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak,
Did you come across something there about slow? Slow to do what? Somebody has said that, you know why God talks about speaking and hearing? In terms of you talk less, he gave you one mouth and two ears. And that man of God said, perhaps God wants you to do less talking and hear more, listen more than talking. May God help us.
Amen.
Well, let's quickly go through this. Oh man. Some steps there that have been suggested, that you must always be the first one, once you recognize that there is a problem between you and somebody, make the first move. Do you agree? Someone was sharing with me about this, and he said that how some people will say you offend them, and they know you have offended them, and you who has offended, you have no clue. And they are expecting you to take the first move. I don't know that I've offended you. Some people felt that he must know because when I passed, he didn't greet me. And he's the one that knows that I didn't greet her. Me, I wasn't looking, or I didn't pay attention. I don't know I've offended you. Who should make the first move? It's you who has it in mind that I did not greet, I failed to greet. We should make the first move. Don't postpone. Don't procrastinate. Some people, there's a saying that time heals. Not in a conflict that must be resolved. That conflict will continue to fester and fester and fester, and it will develop into something else. Perhaps maybe there are some things that time heals, and there are some things that, no, that thing will still be there unless it is confronted. You have to tackle whatever it is. The second step, after you have decided that you are going to make that first move, actually I got this from Warren and some items from our minister's manual and other material from our church. About you make the first move, ask God for wisdom. After that, have made a decision that you want to make a move, let God guide you. Ask for help. Plan a peace conference. Ask God to tell you the right time and the right place. Because you are after peace, you don't just want to greet anyhow. So that it will just be for the sake of the letter of the law rather than the spirit of the law. I love the third one, and I think it was when I was reading that. He said that always start with self-check. Always ask yourself, what is my fault in this? Don't look at the fault of your husband or your wife or your children first. When there is a conflict, always ask what is my fault. Not what others have done. Look inside yourself first. And it says that if you are filled with peace of Jesus, you will approach something in a special way, because you are not going to approach it with upset, with anger. That is why you need to pray for wisdom when you want to approach that thing. He said that some people should first of all deal with their self-centeredness. He said that, I read this, he said that it doesn't mean that you are doing everything, but you just want peace. Even what this person is doing, you don't agree with it, then first of all, you start inside yourself. These are two of us in this. I have some areas that I need to go into. Pride, he says, often the problem where you cannot even start with, I'm sorry. This expert of marriage matter says that if we always approach a matter by saying, I was only thinking of myself, when you approach your wife, or your husband, or your children, or your parent in a conflict, and you look inside, and you first of all identify the area that has contributed to it, and you start by saying, I think I was thinking only of myself. This man of God said, you will see how the face and the demeanor of the person you are talking to will show. Because of the words that you are using. So he said, identify your own blind spot, just as we have in Matthew chapter 7, verse 3 and 5. Don't start with their problem, start with your problem. When you want to resolve, you will be over demanding, looking well and find yourself. Then the next step, proactive, active listening. This is very, very important. You say when people feel that they are not listened to, they don't feel that they are valued. So you must be sure that you listen very carefully. 2 ears, 1 mouth, always listen before you speak. Philippians 2:4-5. Learn to be
understanding rather than to be understood. I said that I'm learning something. It's good to prepare things like this. Because the more you read and study and you pray about it, then you see yourself. Learn to be understanding rather than to be understood. Many times I always want people to understand me. Then you understand others. May God help us.
Amen.
I love this one. Stefan says, speak truth with love. You know that from Peter 4:15. This speaker says something like, some people say that, I just say the way it is. He said, don't work. Don't just say the way it is. Nothing like that. You have to speak the truth in love. Don't say the way it is. Wrap the truth with love. Don't say the way it is. Say, it's not what you say, is it not true? But how you are saying what you are saying. There is a saying that if you say offensively, you will receive defensively. Now listen to this. He said we should be aware, we should be aware of certain words that we want to say in this school. We don't want to use this. When I came across this in my study, I remember Stella and I have said something like this before, and I was trying to remember what God was like. He said, we ban that word in this school from now on. And this writer is saying that there are certain words we need to ban. We don't want to hear it from you again, and never will it come out of your mouth again. You know where there is conflict? We say things we don't mean to say, don't we?
Yes.
We behave the way we don't mean to behave. Then let us set some parameters for ourselves and let that be there. Irrespective of how high, how low the situation is created, certain words, we never said this one that this man gave example. He said, don't ever say things like, I will divorce you because you are not careful. Don't ever say that word in us. But there is no option. There is no way there. Don't ever say, I will leave you. Those are bad words to say. And many times we say things that we don't mean to say. So he said that ban some harmful words in your home. They are weapons of mass destruction. Colossians 3:8 has something to tell us about that. The next step is to fix the problem, not the blame. Fix the problem. Concentrate on the problem. Focus on the problem. Attack the issue, not the person. Many of us, we attack each other. When we should attack, what is the issue? Leave the other person. Let us identify the issue and attack that issue. Then many times we deal with the issue, then we are talking about our reactions, about our behaviors, and we are not dealing with the problem. We are just causing more problems.
Yes.
Don't intimidate or threaten or blame them for insult. Finally, it says that we should focus on reconciliation to reestablish our relationship. We have to resolve what we have to resolve. We can disagree, but we can be disagreeing. We can disagree, but not disagree, we are meant to say. Do you understand that? We can disagree, but not disagree. Unity is not uniformity. Conflict is inevitable. And I like the one that I added, which is, reconciliation is not automatic. Don't let us leave that conflict and say, one day it will go. It's not automatic. Pray as you go through this process, ready to listen for the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and God will help you. You will know that saying in the Word of God in Proverbs 16:7, when a man's way, what would You know where the word of God says his enemy. Your wife is not your enemy. Your husband is not your enemy. Your parents are not your enemy. Your children are not your enemy. Just conflict, small thing. Imagine what God will do. God will bring peace. If my way, if your way will please the Lord, that conflict will resolve. Closing remark. Be an agent of peace and reconciliation. Some people are always like to fight and fight and fight. There are that verse of the scripture that says that I am for peace, but they are for war. Don't let people who are for war make you to get into war. Remain in peace. And God will help you. God will bring things that will resolve issues in your home. Pray. Lord, help me to regard the extreme broken relationship in my family, so that I can have fellowship with you here and with you eternally. Amen. God is going to help us to resolve all conflict.
Amen.
My last slide is from our church on resolving this court. We have the material from the Apostolic Faith Organization on resolving this court, and this is what they give for husband and wife. Ask yourself the following questions, which I want husband and wife to look into for themselves. Please let us see those questions that we have to ask us. And be honest, am I patient? Do I admit my fault? Go through that, you don't rush to buy. They are rushing to buy now. Go on thinking if you are mad. But ask yourself those questions genuinely in order to be an agent of peace in your home. If you will go through this and challenge yourself to do the right thing, God is going to help you. And resolving conflict, we have asked some questions there to finish up. In resolving conflict and choosing the accommodation strategy, should be one side. That is because women are good persons. The husband should only do like a friend. Can there be a few practical examples and how it was resolved? I don't know which one is referring to here. The accommodation was on, the example I gave was on Abraham and Lot. That's accommodation. You win. I don't mind. Leave me here. You first. I come second. That's what we are saying. In terms of accommodation, yes, you get it.
What the person means is that, does it mean you have to meet the husband that must act like Abraham and say
to the wife, you have your way? Or is it both the husband and the wife that can act?
Okay. You have to forgive me. You know, maybe the way I was talking, I'm making that mistake. I mean, because I'm a man. I cannot remember that. That's exactly what I mean, just like Chetmo's question, is we are talking of a Christian here. We are not saying the man is the one to be like Abraham. Do you think that makes sense?
No.
It has to be, if we both will do that, there will be no conflict, isn't it? But if one, it can be anyone that doesn't just want to be like Abraham, you be like Abraham. Wife, be like Abraham. Husband, be like Abraham. In terms of after you, we are not talking of sin. We are talking of differences. After you. I know maybe this person will be coming from the handbook. Wife submit. You think that's where they're coming from?
No, it's from the aspect of where the woman always says she's the weaker person, so she's the one that should be, I mean, be the Lord. Why the husband must be the Abraham?
Okay.
Because
he's
there.
Because
women are
weak persons. Okay, I didn't touch on why, honestly speaking, unless I know what the person is referring to, that the answer I was coming from is not the angle of women should be the weaker person, should always be the one
on the other side and the male. I'm talking of God's children in general. And any of them. Okay, perhaps in all that you have said, thank you for your questions, and I know some questions possibly could not come through. Some questions possibly are personal that you may want to ask. Feel free to send this to your pastor, to any of your ministers, if you feel like, and send them to me. We can sit down to prayerfully look at some of these together. But for now, we want to have some session to pray together, even if it is just for a few minutes, on areas that must have touched you. I want to pray on areas that I know have been touched in this presentation in terms of what you have said and what you have shared. Yes, Bratu, is something coming up?
I was trying to, maybe because of our time, I was trying to suggest if from various sessions, maybe one from Manchester, one from Peckham, or one from Bessie, to hear practical examples of conflict and how they resolve in their various homes. Maybe it could be a lesson. Maybe some parents, some families can benefit from. Like, if somebody give an example, this morning I had a misunderstanding with my wife, this was what caused it, and this was how we resolved it, and things like that, so that people will know that it's not just theory, it's practical.
Are we all hearing from different branches that suggestion? I think I've given you my own temperature. It's still there. Because I'm still cold blooded. I'm still cold blooded. But we are still together. By the grace of God, we've been together for about 30 years. And by the grace of God, it's going to be until death. Do us part. Anybody here who want to kick start? Or if you want to send some message to Brother Lazarus or Brother Twee on sharing, that I know that an area that many people would not possibly like to talk about. It's not easy to say, my wife and myself this morning, we were arguing about, you know, there are some things that people just don't like to really share in that kind of area.
Okay, one last message for Betsy.
From Betsy. How do I resolve conflict when things are wrong and I bring attention of my partner to it, but we always develop things clean? Big offense, offense, offense. And we'll be war for the whole week. This happens no matter how voice is being managed and how you try to paint it to avoid issue. God will help you. With all due respect, I'm not joking about it, I'm not laughing about it, with all due respect, that all I can pick from this is God will help such a person. We have people like that. We have people like that. You remember what I said about, I want peace, there's some people who just want war. And they are the first one to jump up and testify to salvation, sanctification, Holy Ghost baptism, as current as yesterday. I don't have the answer. I can just be praying along with you. And if you feel that you want to bring this up with your pastor so that your pastor can intervene, there's nothing wrong in that. Your pastor can intervene at that other spouse to be somebody to have a chat together and look at it. Maybe this one that we have read is from one angle. Somebody that is just shouting, shouting, shouting all the time, may not be, it's not much. There may be other issues. So maybe you want to have confidence in any of the ministers to bring such a thing up and have a chat about it. And I pray that the Lord God Almighty will resolve that conflict.
Amen.
Who wants to say something? Ramoyo,
mine is just a request for the handout of this slide. The handout.
Handout of the slides. Okay? Okay, there's a request for the handout of the slides. I've not seen it there. I'll let you have that. They're sending this to me.
Okay. You see, some of these things we can't deal with. The lady said, in this home or in this marriage, it don't take me and you. It's only God. Thank you. Well, these are some of the things you want to ban in your home. Sister, if you are listening, the lady said in this home or in this marriage, it won't take me and you. I don't know what it means fully, but I can see that there is a conflict. God will resolve that conflict. Since you are married, it has to take you and he's married and it is for life. I don't have answer to some of these things, but again, if they are not brought up to examine and talk over, it's difficult to really say, do this and do that. And I want to believe you will appreciate that. Certainly coming in from sharing of those things, I really wouldn't think many will come through. I just want us to spend some time to pray and resolve and pray that God will help us. Remember what I said about we don't want to have a disfellowship with God. We want to have fellowship with God. And in order to do that, we must have good fellowship with our wife, our husband, our children, and our parents. And we want to tell God that whatever the issue is, God, please, come and help. This is a very big topic that we will return to, should we need to, not tarrying during the course of next year, on conflict resolution. God bless you. Let's go on our knees to pray. God, thank you very much, our people from France, Spain, and all the branches. We want to take some time to pray. Pray till any time you like. Take those issues that are concerning to you to the Lord in prayer. Pray till whenever you like, and we just pray that the Lord will answer your prayers. The Lord will answer my prayers. The Lord will give us peace in our homes and give us peace in our church, so that the church can concentrate on the propagation of the gospel to which we have been committed. God bless you all, and thank you for joining this forum. Let's go on our knees to pray. Good night.